Why do some antibiotics no longer work? Well, to answer that question, we have to go back in time a few years and find out a bit about the history of antibiotics. We all have heard of antibiotics, right? Simply put, they are a class of medicines that inhibit or kill microbes. Before antibiotics were discovered, any small cut or minor infection could mean death. But in 1928, everything changed. Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin, and all of a sudden, doctors could treat illnesses that used to be fatal. Soon, research into penicillin picked up pace, and it could be synthesized in the labs. Antibiotics seemed to be so helpful that by the 1950s, they were even introduced to farm animals and fishes. By the next decade, most of the major classes of antibiotics we use today were already discovered. Today, we use antibiotics for everything, from simple ailments like upset stomach to more severe infections like pneumonia, tuberculosis, typhoid, and so on. The problem is that because antibiotics are so helpful against disease-causing microbes, they are used by everyone and very often. The result is that some of the microbes no longer respond to the antibiotics once effective against them. Overuse of antibiotics may be more harmful to us than good. In fact, it may create more dangerous infections or leave us totally unarmed against all infections over time. So how can something that kills microbes actually create more dangerous ones? For the answer, we must look back again in time. 12 years after the discovery of penicillin, two scientists reported that certain strains of bacteria could produce chemicals that could render penicillin useless. As more and more people used penicillin, the strains that couldn't make the anti-penicillin chemical started dying out. The result was that the strains that could resist the action of penicillin became more common. Now let's think about what happens when we take any antibiotic during infections. The microbes that cause the disease start dying. But all the microbes are not identical. Some can naturally withstand greater amounts of the antibiotic. So, by the time we finish the course, the few microbes that survive are the most capable of resisting the effect of the antibiotic. When the next person gets affected by the surviving microbes, the same drug has even less impact on the microbes as they are already more capable of resisting the drug's action than before. Over time, with repeating the cycles of infection and killing of the microbes that cannot prevent the action of the drug, we end up with microbes on which the antibiotic has no effect at all. This is called drug resistance. Drug resistance has become more common as the use of drug has increased, especially since they are sometimes used without even consulting a doctor. In fact, many patients do not finish the full course of antibiotics, thus ensuring the survival of the resistant microbes. A significant source of drug resistance is places like research centers and hospitals, where many antibiotics are used and microbes have a greater chance of developing resistance. Moreover, overuse of antibiotics in livestock and fish farming results in people getting infected by strains of microbes which are more resistant to antibiotics to begin with. And the most worrying problem is that drug discovery is a slow process. By the time a new drug comes along, many microbes get ample time to show drug resistance. Now, some strains of microbes are naturally resistant to some drugs. Such variation is typical of all living things. But the problem with bacteria is that when they are exposed to excessive amounts of antibiotics, they start showing spontaneous mutations. This can lead to new strains which show higher resistance to the drug. The situation is even worse because bacteria seem to share portions of the DNA amongst neighbors. When drug resistance genes appears in some of them, they get spread in the population very quickly. With so much exposure to antibiotics of different types, bacteria have been forced to become resistant to more than one antibiotic. It is as if we are selectively breeding new varieties of more and more dangerous microbes. In fact, such bacteria are called superbugs, capable of super resistance. So why should we be worried? Diseases like TB, which had become manageable, are now once again becoming a serious threat to life in India. They are no longer responsive to the drugs that were once a sure treatment for them. In fact, as far back as 1984, the famous author George Orwell died from being infected by a drug-resistant form of TB. So the problem is not new, but it is becoming more serious. people in hospitals who are often more likely to be unable to fight off infections naturally get infected by drug-resistant forms of pneumonia and suffer needlessly. Researchers are constantly trying to produce better and more effective antibiotics. So we are not entirely back to the dark ages yet. In the meantime, doctors must also be careful in identifying diseases and prescribing antibiotics with more caution. Unrestrained use of antibiotics will be extremely dangerous very soon. If we want to ensure that a few years from now, we can still enjoy the protection that antibiotics offer against diseases, we must be only responsible ourselves. We must only take antibiotics when prescribed by a doctor, and when we do take antibiotics, we must ensure that we follow the proper dosage and complete the entire course. If we act responsibly, there is no reason that we have to be afraid of so-called superbugs.